Mr. N plus 1 was never really into math. He always wondered why his parents gave him a name related to math. He was into English. He was going to college to major in English. Mr. N plus 1 was walking to his English class one day when... I wonder what we'll learn today.
We'll go!
This would change his life forever. Unbeknownst to Mr. N plus 1 at the time, evil Dr. Integral knew that he would thrive. He initiated a plan to make Mr. N plus 1 a hero in math. From that moment on, math was no longer difficult for Mr. N plus 1. In fact, he became... Math Man!
Come, Revolver. Our time has finally come.
Alyssa LaGrange worked for a paper about math as a journalist, and was also Dr. Evil Integral's plan to destroy Math Man. Alyssa is in trouble! Math Man!
Dearest Alyssa, call for your hero, Math Man, so that I may defeat him once and for all, with the help of my secret weapon.
Hey!
Ah, Math Man, there you-
He broke my arm!
You broke her arm?
No, I was just being very careful. She slipped, I swear.
Prepare to lose, Dr. Evil Integral.
Math Showdown!
Part A, find the area of Region R. You have 10 minutes.
I believe in you, Math Man.
Part B, revolve R around Y equals negative 2.
I have to finish both parts in 10 minutes? Wait, who are you?
This is my secret weapon, the revolver. Now you only have 9 minutes left.
I don't know how to do this.
9 minutes later.
Time is up, Math Man. I have defeated you.
Ugh.
Sir? I can't help but notice that you just got whooped by evil Dr. Integral.
Who are you?
I am Constant Girl. And I think I know just the person to help you out. Here is where your training begins. Mrs. Wells is a wonderful teacher. Mrs. Wells?
Yes. Oh, a new student!
Hi, I'm Mr. N plus 1.
But really, he's...
Math Man!
And I'm Constant Girl!
Wonderful! Then I can be my true identity also. The fundamental theorem of calculus. Don't worry, student. You don't learn about me until chapter 5. Time to study for the AP test. Mr. Evil Integral's most evil weapon. Don't worry. If you study as hard as you can and do your best, you will pass the AP test. Now let me introduce you to someone who can help you begin learning. Line Man.
Beginning chapter 1. Are you ready? Go!
Math Man, I am Line Man, and I'll teach you new abilities to defeat problems. What do you know about lines?
I know that on a line, the slope of a line with points x1 and y1 and x2 and y2 is equal to rise over run. This is also equal to y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1.
Wonderful. Now let me teach you a new ability to find lines, points, slope. The equation y equals m x minus x1 plus y1 is the point slope equation of a line with x1 and y1 with slope m. Try it.
There!
Awesome! Now let me teach you about symmetry of lines.
Lines can be symmetric?
Yes, and this one's evenly symmetric, and this one's odd. Even functions are reflected across the y-axis, and odd functions are reflected across the origin.
Like sine, cosine, and tangent. Hi, I'm Sokotoa. I love the nature of math. Sine and tangent are odd, and cosine is even. They are measured in degrees and radians. Can I teach you them? The thing I know about right triangles is you can't solve them without Sokotoa. The graph is always changing, always flowing. I know once more, just around the church fronts, we all adore sine, cosine, and tangent. Don't know what they might send. Just around the trig functions. Just around the trig functions.
Okay, I get it. So, the six trig functions are sine, cosine, tangent, secant, cosecant, and cotangent, right?
Right! And they are measured in radians and degrees. What is 45 degrees in radian form?
Pi fourths?
Correct. And remember, in a right triangle, sine of an angle is equal to opposite over hypotenuse. Cosine of an angle is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse. And tangent angle is equal to opposite over adjacent.
Thanks, Sokotoa.
You're welcome. I'm off to solve more right triangles. Bye!
Have you understood it so far, Math Man?
I think so. Let's start chapter 2. Starting chapter 2. Take a deep breath. Relax. Are you ready? Go!
Now let me introduce you to one of my good friends, The Limit.
Hey, Line Man, what's up?
The Limit is kind of like my psychiatrist. He helps me determine whether I'm convergent or divergent. I'll let him explain some.
Exactly, Line Man. I hope you know that. Lemma of f of x is x goes to c equals l, l being a number. So the limit as this graph approaches c is approximately...
4, right?
Yes, exactly.
I guess that's pretty easy.
Now we'll make it harder. Limits of functions can be approached from both sides, for example. The limit of c as it is approached from the right is denoted limit of x approaches c positive f of x from the left, limit f of x as x approaches c negative. What is the limit of f of x as x approaches 0 negative and limit of f of x as x approaches 0 positive?
From the right, the limit would be 4, and from the left, negative 3? Correct!
The reason this graph has different limits when approached from both sides is because there is a discontinuity in the graph. There are four types of discontinuities. Removable, jump, infinite, and oscillating. To help you understand the oscillating discontinuity, Mr. Sandwich Theorem will explain to you.
The sandwich theorem states that g of x is less than or equal to f of x, which is less than or equal to blah, 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 blah.
Thank you, Mr. Sandwich Theorem. Don't worry, you don't need to know that. I know this is a lot to take in, but you'll do fine.
Hey guys,
hold it right there!
Dr. Evil Integral?
And the revolver.
Wait, the gun is real?
Yes, let me show you how real.
Ow! Line Man!
I've been hit!
It's a whole discontinuity! How do I fix it?
You can't take the derivative at that point.
What?
Mathman, move on to chapter 3 and learn about derivatives. Avenge me!
His eyes are horizontal asymptotes. He is no more. Remember what you learned in chapter 2. Avenge Lineman by learning how to take derivatives.
Starting chapter 3, derivatives. You will love them. Ready? Go.
It's time we part our ways, Mathman. But before I go, I want to give you this bumper sticker. Since you don't have a car, you can wear them on your uniform.
Thanks, The Limit.
No problem.
I'll just put it on the underwear that I wear over my pants.
Sweet, now I'll introduce you to your new teacher, Mrs. Derivative.
Hello, Mathman. I am Mrs. Derivative.
Mrs. Derivative? What exactly is a derivative?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. The definition of a derivative is the limit as h goes to 0 of x plus h minus x all over h. It can also be written as f derivative of a equals the limit as x goes to a of f of x minus f of a all over x minus a, provided the limit exists.
I have to remember what I learned in chapter 2.
Sadly, yes. But in order to understand this new concept, you need to try it out. Try solving f of x equals x cubed minus 2x squared using both definitions.
It's 3x squared minus 4x.
There are also four ways to write the derivative. Y prime, dy over dx, df over dx, d over dx of f at x. Don't worry, taking derivatives of functions just takes a lot of practice. After a little while, taking derivatives becomes second nature.
5 seconds later.
What is the derivative of 3x minus 12?
3!
7x.
7!
27x squared.
54x!
See? You already get it.
Yay!
What's the derivative of sine of x times x squared? This is called the product rule. The answer is cosine of x times 2x plus x squared times sine of x. The opposite is the quotient rule. Sine of x over x squared equals x squared cosine of x minus sine x 2x all over x to the fourth. These are all different rules of derivatives. Another is the chain rule. Professor Chain Rule can teach you about that.
Greetings, Mathman. As you have found out, derivatives can get complex. You can take derivatives of sine, cosine, tangent, and the natural logs of functions, logarithms, functions, raised to other functions, etc., which leads to the chain rule. The chain rule is a derivative of a composite function. It is written f of g derivative of x equals f derivative g of x times g derivative of x. Remember, derivative of the outside, leave the inside alone, times the derivative of the inside. Try it.
Is it 2x cosine of x squared? Wow, that seems easier than expected.
Just keep up the good work. If you keep practicing, it'll be second nature. Chapter 4 is pretty well a continuation of Chapter 3. Let me add another item into your uniform. Now the MVT.
Hola, Mathman. ¿Cómo estás? I'm here to teach you the mean value theorem.
The mean value theorem? Is that what NVT stands for? It sounds kind of mean. Is it easy?
Oh, don't worry. Es fácil. The mean value theorem states that if y equals f of x and is continuous at f prime of c equals f of b minus f of a over b minus a.
Why is this useful?
The MVT connects the average rate of change and instantaneous rate of change. It means there is at least one tangent parallel to the interval. There is another thing we can do with derivatives. We can take the derivatives of derivatives. When we do this, we find that the derivative of position is velocity. The derivative of velocity is acceleration, and the derivative of acceleration is jerk. If you look at the graphs of these derivatives, you can find minimums and maximums and points of inflections. This can be done by looking at the first and second derivatives of the function. Remember to do your homework, because practice makes perfect.
Wait right there.
Dr. Evil Integral!
You are learning quickly and improving, Mathman. However, I need to humble you to make sure you don't get too confident. What's the derivative of inverse tangent x cubed plus 4?
I can solve this. Oh, brain fart.
The answer is 3x squared all over x to the 9th plus 8x cubed plus 17.
Grr. Integral power.
Math Man, are you okay?
Whoa, how did I do that?
Dr. Evil Integral strikes again!
What happened? How come the derivatives and integrals canceled out? When did I learn to shoot derivatives? I don't understand!
I think you're ready to start Chapter 5.
Beginning Chapter 5. This also includes Chapter 6. Smiley face. Ready to learn about Mrs. Wells?
Fundamental Theorem of Calculus?
It's time.
Good! Let me teach you about integrals. Integrals are antiderivatives. They are backwards derivatives. That's why they cancel each other out. There are two types of integrals, definite and indefinite. A definite integral has limits on top and bottom, whereas indefinite don't. For example, the integral of f of x dx from a to b is definite. But you need to remember that the functions are often representatives of the position graphs. Just take the derivatives backwards.
So, the antiderivative of jerk is acceleration, and the acceleration is velocity, and the antiderivative of velocity is position?
Exactly.
But what happens when you take the antiderivative of position?
You find the area. Don't worry, we'll do lots of practice. Now let me explain the fundamental theorem of calculus. If f, a function, is continuous on the closed interval from a to b, then capital F of x is equal to the integral f of t dt from a to x, and the derivative of capital F df dt is equal to the derivative of the integral f of t dt from a to x, and that's equal to f of x. Try solving this problem using the Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, or FTC.
Is it zero?
Now solve this problem with the knowledge you have of integrals.
Is the answer 6?
Good work, Math Man. I hope you noticed that instead of an x in the function, there was a z. This is because they are dummy variables. You can put anything instead of x. Put that on the back of your shirt. Now I'll introduce you to...
Wait! You forgot indefinite integrals. That's where the constant comes in. At the end of indefinite integrals, there might be a constant, because the derivative of numbers is zero. You need to remember plus c. Try it.
Is the answer...
You forgot plus c!
Okay, the answer is x to the 4th over 4 plus 7 thirds x cubed plus 12x plus c.
Now we'll introduce you to Josh Simpson's rule.
My rule states that you can approximate the integral from a to b of f of x dx as... 1/3 h, parentheses, initial y plus 4y sub 1 plus 2y sub 2 plus 4y sub 3 plus dot 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 plus 2y sub n minus 2 plus 4y sub n minus 1 plus y sub n, where a to b is partitioned into equal even subintervals. These are all different ways to apply integrals. This will be very much of what you will do on your way to the AP test. Try out the Simpson's rule. Take the integral from 0 to 2 of 5x to the 4th dx.
Is it 385 divided by 12?
Correct! There are many ways to find areas under curves. There's LRAM, RRAM, MRAM, the trapezoidal rule, and the Simpson's rule. These are all approximations of the integrals of curves. And remember, practice makes perfect.
You forgot my method. Hi, I'm Euler. My method states that L of x equals y sub 0 plus the function evaluated x sub 0, y sub 0, times dx. This is a linearization of different functions.
How did you get to be so big?
I'm on the AP test a lot, so I get people lots of points. I'm not that hard to solve either. I'm free points. Want to try it?
Is the answer 1.2?
Correct.
Thanks, Euler.
Don't pronounce my name wrong,
Tanner.
Just remember that you're solving it with Y prime. Don't anti-derive before you solve Euler. Starting chapter 7. Don't forget about me. Are you ready?
Go, 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 go.
Hello, Math Man. I'm Volume Girl. One of the properties of integrals is the ability to create volumes using them. When you have the area of a function, you can integrate from a to b, ax, dx. There's another way to find volumes. You can
revolve them.
Whoa!
I can control any volume I want.
Put her down!
First, solve this function.
(32π/5).
Grr, you defeated me.
Thanks, Math Man. You need to remember how to solve those functions. There are lots of those functions on the AP test. If you get good at them, you can get free points. Taking the arc length of curves is important, too. Integrate from a to b the square root of 1 plus dy dx squared dx is the formula to find arc lengths. If you remember that you can find lengths of curves, in the case of corners, vertical tangents, and cusps, you can take the integrals around the indifferentiability. Practice makes perfect. Now, let me introduce you to L'Hopital.
Starting chapter 8. Ready? Go!
Hello, Mathman. I am L'Hopital. You're almost there, just two more chapters. L'Hopital's rule. The limit as x approaches a of f of x over g of x equals the limit of x as x approaches a of the derivative of f of x over the derivative of g of x. This is possible only in the indeterminate forms. They are 0 over 0, infinity over infinity, infinity minus infinity, infinity times 0, the 1 to infinity, 0 to 0, and infinity to 0. Remember that this isn't the quotient rule, Alex. That is f derivative of f of x over the derivative of g of x. Always remember to check for an indeterminate form first. Don't be afraid to differentiate until you find the answer. This tells you about the end behavior. Do you want to try it?
One third.
Correct! Using my rule, you don't have to have any trouble finding end behaviors. Keep practicing and keep up the good work. Now, let me introduce you to my good friends, Taylor and McLaren.
Hello, Math Man. I'm McLaren. Let me teach you about
my series! You stole my work!
I did nothing of the sort! You are the one who stole Gregor's work!
How was I supposed to know someone else was already thinking about that? Or thought I was the first?
Wait, what is a Taylor series anyways?
Oh, hey Math Man, sorry about that. There are many kinds of series. A Taylor series is the formula to find them.
The formula for a Taylor series is f of a plus f derivative of a of x plus f second derivative of a x minus a squared over 2 factorial plus dot 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 plus f to the n times x minus a to the n over n factorial plus dot dot dot. It is written infinity over the little e sign of n equals o of f to the n x minus a to the n all over n factorial.
A McLaren series is any Taylor series generated by f at x equals 0. There are already many McLaren series out for your benefit. What here, couple?
The Maclaurin series of sine of x is x minus x cubed over 3 factorial plus x to the 5 over plus dot 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 plus negative 1 to the n x to the 2n plus 1 all over 2n plus 1 factorial plus dot dot dot.
And the Maclaurin series of ln of 1 plus x is x minus x squared over 2 plus x cubed over 3 minus x to the 4th over 4 plus dot 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 plus negative 1 to the n minus 1 x to the n over n plus dot dot dot.
A purpose of a series is to find whether they converge or diverge.
You can also find the radius of convergence.
Or the remainder.
Alyssa, your arms are better.
Thanks to you, Math Man. As you got better at math, my arm got better. Are you ready to learn about Lagrange error bounds? It states that the error between the original function and the Taylor series is the remainder of x is less than or equal to f to the n plus 1 of c times x minus a to the n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 factorial.
This is why you were originally named mrn plus 1 after the remainder estimation theorem.
Try some problems.
Three plus x minus 1 plus 6 times x minus 1 squared over 2 factorial plus 6 times x minus 1 cubed over 3 factorial. This is a geometric series.
Math Man, go and begin chapter 10. We may not be there to help you on the AP test.
So just remember what you learned here.
Beginning the last chapter, chapter 10. Ready?
Welcome to the last chapter, Math Man. I'm Patty Parametrics.
And I'm Patrick Poehler.
And I am Vector!
I'm committing crimes with both direction and magnitude! Oh yeah!
However, there's more to vectors than committing crime. They must be written in component form. V sub 1 comma V sub 2. Maybe you have to find the angle between two vectors using G equals inverse cosine U times V plus U times V over the magnitude of U times V. The magnitude of a vector is the square root of v squared plus v squared, and a unit vector is a vector with a magnitude of 1. Fear not, Math Man, for these aren't as hard as you think. I must be off. Fare thee well!
Vectors aren't all that Chapter 10 is about. It's also about parametrized curves.
And polar functions!
Some parametric functions are twice differentiable. The formula for this is dy derivative of dt over the dx dt. The arc length of a curve is the integral from a to b of the square root of dx over dt squared plus dy over dt squared dt. And also, you can find the surface areas of a smooth curve. The surface area equals the integral from a to b of 2 pi x of the square root of dx over dt squared plus dy over dt squared dt. There's more to parametrics than this, but now it's time for polar.
Polar functions can relate back to Cartesian coordinates. X equals r cosine theta, y equals r sine theta, x squared plus y squared equals r squared, and y over x equals tangent theta. You can also find the slope of a curve, dy over d theta, all over dx over d theta. The area of a polar curve is the integral from a to b of 1 half r squared d theta. And I think that's all. Good luck, Math Man. It's time for the AP test.
I don't think I'm ready. There's so much I still need to learn. I'm so nervous about the AP test. Is it all going to work out?
Don't give up hope, Math Man. You are Lambert. You can conquer big problems like the AP test. And don't give up hope. Remember.
We believe in you, Math Man!
I know you're ready for the AP test. Go defeat Dr. Evil Integral!
I think I'm ready for the AP test.
Prepare to lose, Math Man.
I'm ready.
Dear students, you represent Math Man. You get to decide your future. You have prepared as hard as you could. Now you can defeat Dr. Evil Integral. You will do amazing on the AP test. I know what score you are going to get.
make a big noise playing in the street. Gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace. Kicking your can all over the place, singing,
we will rock you. We will rock you.
Buddy, you're a young man, hard man, shouting in the street. Gonna take on the world someday. You got blood on your face, a big disgrace. Waving your banner all over the place. Somebody better put your bag into your place.
We will rock you.